invite Mark Cruella, the professor and chair of Computer Science Department, to moderate this panel. And a quick reminder for those of you who joined us late, the structure of the panel is that you're going to have four talks back-to-back in quick succession, each of them 10 minutes long, and we request all of you to hold your questions till the very end, and we'll have plenty of time built in for a Q&A session at the end of the panel, and then you can ask all your questions there. So with that, I'll ask Mark to begin the session.
Okay, thank you, Prakash. And thank you for the opportunity to introduce this panel, because I've, as somebody who's worked studying data derived from networks for many years, I'm really excited by the opportunity to present to you the four speakers we have today. So the panel today is concerns networks, data associated with networks. And I'll just say one thing, which is that what's remarkable to me about the study of networks and data coming from networks is the huge diversity of fields that this idea or this sort of principle touches on, and how remarkably we can move insights from one field to a completely different field when the underlying question is something that has to do with data, with networks. So I'll introduce our first speaker today, Jay Bohland, who is an assistant professor in both the Department of Health Sciences and the Department of Speech, Language, and Hearing Sciences here in Sargent College. And he's going to speak to you about mining gene expression data in the mouse and human brain.
Thanks, Mark, and thanks for the invitation to talk here today. In the area of the area in which data science intersects neuroscience is often called neuroinformatics. This is kind of a relatively new term, but we can get a sense of sort of how much this has had an impact on the field of neuroscience simply by looking at how often this term appears in the literature. So in this plot here, in blue, you see the raw number of occurrences of the term neuroinformatics over the last 15 years. And then in red, it's normalized by a more general term like neuroscience. And you can see very clearly this sort of rapid rise in neuroinformatics over the last five or so years. And this fits very nicely with this sort of recent explosion of data that have come from public and private initiatives making publicly available data sets in neuroscience, which is actually something that's relatively new in our field. So there are a number of these named projects like the Human Connectome Project, the Human Brain Project in the EU, brain initiative projects creating electrophysiological data sets like Mike Hasselmo talked about, for example, and the Allen Brain Atlases, which I'm going to talk about here today. There are also a number of disease-specific data sets that are making a pretty large impact. Two data sets that I'm going to talk about in particular have been created in sort of factory-like fashion at the Allen Institute for Brain Science in Seattle. The first of those was a systematic genome-wide atlas of gene expression in the C57 black adult mouse. This was collected with in situ hybridization. And the second data set was collected in human brains using a custom microarray data technique created data at an anatomical scale that we haven't seen before. So these are some primary data representing the expression of a gene PROX1. It's focally expressed in the dentate gyrus of the hippocampus, which you can see in these primary image data, which are acquired at 1 micron resolution. These things are acquired in many slices, many animals, many genes. They're computationally registered to a common template space. And then that template space is smoothed and resliced into a grid, which you see here, and these are the data that we're analyzing. These are 67 by 41 by 58 volumes for a set of about 4,000 genes that we're looking at here in this data set. So we can cast this problem in a familiar form for data scientists, which is as a matrix, essentially a 50,000 voxel by 4,000 gene matrix, and we can use very kind of fundamental techniques to understand the structure within that matrix. So application of the of principal components analysis by use of the singular value decomposition of that matrix can tell us, for example, that there are interesting relationships between profiles arising from different voxels. And these have been color-coded by the structures from which they were drawn from. And you can see, even in a very low-dimensional space, that different structures express different genes in this high-dimensional multivariate space. Now, the space is not so simple as three-dimensional. We need about 271 principal components to account for 90% of the variance, but we can use this for both dimensionality reduction and noise reduction in these kinds of data. In this reduced dimensional space, it becomes computationally tractable to do things like repeated applications of unsupervised learning techniques like k-means clustering, which has been brought up before. And we can use this and vary the number of clusters, for example, to ask how the brain segments into regions of interest based solely on this notion of gene expression. So this is kind of comparing the molecular level of organization to the conventional neuroanatomical organization that we observe with completely different signals. So on the left of each of these coronal slices, you see the clustering result. And on the right, you see a conventional neuroanatomical atlas, which is derived based on different signals. And in fact, you see that there's a high degree of similarity. So to first approximation, this high-dimensional expression signature does in fact recapitulate something about the cell populations that we think of as comprising different neuroanatomical regions of interest. But we also know that there's spatial autocorrelation that is inherent in this data set. So a neighboring voxel is very likely to have a similar pattern of expression to its neighbors, which is doesn't necessarily tell us that the exact regions of interest actually matter. So we tried to approach this problem by creating an algorithm that creates random partitions of the brain, in this case of the cerebral cortex, which is a structure which a lot of folks have said has very homogeneous gene expression and that we shouldn't really be able to tell one area of the cortex from another based on this kind of signature. And so our question was, can we use a machine learning approach to learn to classify these cortical areas from one another, and then do the classifiers that are trained on the real reference atlas do better than the ones that are trained on these kinds of random partitions of the cerebral cortex? As an aside, these kind of space-filling partitions that we've created can be a lot of fun. We've actually created these random states in the United States and simulated the effects of the Electoral College, but you'll have to ask me about that later. And if we take a look at this back to the brain, we see that in fact it is true that the classifiers do better when they're trained on the real atlas. And in fact, we see a consistent crossover point where even if we train the classifiers on random gene sets, right? We select randomly genes as opposed to selecting genes that seem to be informative about these different areas. We do better on the reference atlas than we do on these random atlases. It's still true that we can classify the random atlases to a high degree of accuracy, but that's simply an artifact of the spatial autocorrelation in the data. So now turning to the human microarray data sets, these have been collected in a number of studies, but they're quite rare because you need postmortem tissue and so on. So there are diverse kinds of data sets that choose between, for example, high anatomical sampling and high population sampling, right, from just a few areas of the brain. And so in this work, we tried to integrate those two data sets and make comparisons explicitly between expression profiles and gene co-expression networks derived from these two different kinds of data sets, using one data set from the Allen Atlas, which consisted of only 6 donors but hundreds of samples anatomically from each of those donors, versus a data set that used hundreds of donors but from only 4 distinct brain regions. And at the bottom left, what you see is that there's some anatomical specificity that actually matches up between these data sets, which are collected using very different techniques, but we can pre-process them and see that, for example, the cerebellum profiles averaged across donors do in fact look like the average cerebellum profile from the Allen Human Brain Atlas. But maybe more interestingly, we can build co-expression networks, which are constructed based on correlations between pairs of genes taken either across the individual donors in the Gibbs data set, or taken across spatial samples in the Allen Human Brain Atlas. And to my knowledge, these had never been compared before. And what we see is that that anatomical specificity for these kind of two different types of networks actually holds up to a lesser degree than the simple expression profiles. But for example, in this spider plot, you can see the cerebellum profile showing its highest similarity to the cerebellar network derived from the Allen Human Brain Atlas. And from these population networks, we can also use algorithms popular in data science like a module detection algorithm to find groups of genes that are very focally co-expressed in a specific area. And so, for example, we found 14 genes that are highly co-expressed in the cerebellum in the population networks. And when we look for co-expression in the Allen Human Brain Atlas, we in fact see a high degree of specificity in the cerebellum and not in other areas. These kinds of sunburst plots are hierarchical, are showing the hierarchical organization of co-expression, and this wedge refers to the cerebellum and each of its subdivisions that we see. So we can see that there's potential for meaningful integration across these data sets. I'm not going to have much time to go into this, but one of the areas I'm really excited about that we've been working on with my graduate student Emma Myers is comparative molecular neuroanatomy. So can we actually look at how similar different brain areas express genes across the mouse brain, which is used very often in models of human neuropsychiatric and neurological disease, to actual human brain samples? And so the very first thing we could do is simply correlate all of the samples taken from the human brain after some pre-processing and deriving some orthologous gene sets, correlate the human brain samples with all of the mouse brain voxels. And you can see from this kind of block diagonal structure of this heat map that you do see some anatomical specificity, but the correlation coefficients are actually quite low for a large number of reasons. We could take that a little bit further and create seed profiles by averaging across samples from a certain brain region in the human, and then walking those across the mouse brain and creating these correlation maps that essentially say, how does that expression profile show up across the mouse brain? And the putative homologous regions are outlined here in blue, and you can see there are differing degrees of similarity for different regions across the mouse and human brain. A question we're really interested in are there certain subsets of genes that really drive the similarity in certain areas compared to other areas? Unfortunately, that's an incredibly difficult computational problem to solve systematically because there are 2^n subsets of genes to test, and we would be doing that from now until the end of time. So we took a different approach where we used a network parcellation algorithm that's quite popular in the transcriptomics world, which is weighted gene co-expression network analysis. This gave us candidate gene sets, which we have used as possibilities for reflecting this kind of enhanced similarity of individual brain regions. In general, what we see is that some modules drive increased similarity quite a bit for different brain regions, and that different modules seem to go with different brain areas. So in general, this tells us a number of things. The availability of these large, well-annotated data sets is something new in neuroscience, and it enables a large number of new analyses, new interpretations of neuroanatomy, new comparisons between species that might eventually give us some increased understanding of the efficacy or failures of a number of mouse models in neuropsychiatric disorders. In terms of improvements, we can do a lot better to integrate across these valuable but diverse data sets, and I showed you a few efforts that we're making in that direction. And one of the most exciting things that we can do is to start thinking about ways to simultaneously infer kind of the regions of interest of the brain or the geography of the brain along with the network topology of the brain. So we often impose these kinds of regions of interest or nodes based on some conventional a priori assumptions, but we would really like to do that in a data-driven way as well. So there are a lot of people to thank, and I'll take questions during the Q&A session. Thanks.
Thanks, Jay. Our next speaker is Josee Dupuis. She's professor and also interim chair in the Biostatistics Department at the School of Public Health, and she's going to speak about understanding the genetic architecture of complex human diseases biomedicine, statistics, and large genomic data sets.
I'd like to thank the organizers for inviting me. Today I'm going to talk about what do I mean by complex genetic disease, some research questions that my group is interested in solving, the type of data that we deal with, the type of statistical analyses that we perform, some example results, and some future directions. So in the last decade, we've been pretty successful at finding genes that are responsible for Mendelian diseases, such as cystic fibrosis, Huntington's disease. Finding the genetic causes of complex disease has been more challenging. And what are some of the complex diseases? We know they're heritable. They run in families, such as type 2 diabetes. But it's not caused by a single gene, such that knowing whether you carry that gene or not will determine whether you have the disease or not. It's caused by multiple genes, and it's also influenced as well by the environment. So some of the questions that I'm interested in is, what are the genes and pathways that are implicated in disease development? Are the genes druggable? Can I find better therapy? Can I use the knowledge to predict who's going to develop the disease? I can measure the genetic material in someone's DNA at birth, so I could determine from the DNA alone who's going to develop type 2 diabetes, obesity, I could target intervention really early in someone's life. How do these genes interact to increase disease susceptibility? What are the function of the genes that are implicated? Can I use this information to develop better therapy? And what's the role of the environment? Are there interactions with the environment? Is the environment modifying the effect of the genes? So the data that I work with is data collected on human participants from either case control or cohort study. A lot of my work is done on the Framingham Heart Study, which is a long study that started in 1948, collecting data on about 5,000 people in the town of Framingham, and they've been followed up to these days. And it's a three-generation study, so they've recruited their offspring and their grandchildren as well. I'm interested in type 2 diabetes, so the type of data that we'll collect is disease status, but also lots of quantitative traits that are related to the disease of interest. So fasting glucose level for type 2 diabetes, body mass index, there's some DEXA, the bone mineral density, there's tons and tons and tons of data. And the data, although some of you are collecting data continuously on a minute by second by second, the data we collect is more like annually or biannually. People come back every year, every other year, every 4 year for exams. We collect data on risk factors such as smoking status, weight, diet, physical activity. And these can be measured once, sometimes as a special exam to do bone mineral density. Other times these are collected over time. There's also a lot of genetic and genomic data that we have access to. So we have genetic variants available on a large number of these participants. The human genome contains 3 billion base pair, and most of it is identical among all of us. What matters is the what's different, the 0.1% that's different. So there are millions of these genetic variants that are collected. And on the Framingham participant, we have about 500,000 that are collected right now. And from that 500,000, using databases of publicly available database, I can infer or impute 80 million of these variants. So I have 80 million pieces of information on my 15,000 participants or so. And the genetic variant can also, why am I interested? I'm trying to determine what influenced disease risk. Why is it that two people who look the same, one will develop the disease and the other will not? I have gene expression also. So I have gene expression on about 5,000 people, and the gene expression is measured on 20,000 genes. It can be summarized at the exon level or at the gene level, and it can be measured in a single tissue or in multiple tissues, and it can be measured by one technology or multiple technologies. And I also have access to methylation data. Methylation data can be measured genome-wide or in a multiple tissue. It can alter the gene function. So I'm trying to take all of this information that I have on every single participant and try to determine what's different between the people who have the disease or will develop the disease and who will not. The analysis that I do ranges from very simple to more sophisticated. The most basic analysis that we do is called a genome-wide association study. We test each genetic variant, so we measure the genetic variant in individuals, and it's the data that we have is categorical 0, 1, 2, depending on how many numbers of rare alleles or minor alleles a person carries, and I see whether that is correlated with my phenotype or the disease or the quantitative trait of interest. So I get thousands of millions of test results, and I need to sort that out. It ranged for more sophisticated analysis, systems biology approach that models all type of data jointly and may incorporate prior information that I have from databases and other annotation out there. And that involves a multidisciplinary team of clinicians, molecular biologists, bioinformaticians, statisticians, to appropriately model the data. And that's where network would come into play. One of my biggest challenges is the correlation between the observations. I have a PhD in statistics, and most of my classes by my professor started, assume that X is IID, for identically independently distributed. Well, none of my data are IID. And everything is correlated. So I have multiple correlated measure of disease status. I have type 2 diabetes. I have fasting glucose. I have fasting insulin. I have it at one time point. I have it at multiple time point. I have correlation about my genetic variant. What you measure a genetic variant in a genomic region, there'll be correlation in that genetic region. So they're not independent. I have correlation between my data type. My gene expression might be correlated with my genetic variant. And I also have, in the Framingham Heart Study, started with 5,000 people in the town of Framingham. It did not start a genetic study, but there were tons of relatives in there, sister that were included in the original cohort. Then they recruited the offspring, and then they recruited their grandchildren. So I have correlation among my participants. So I need to account for the multiple tests, for the issue of multiple testing in, because I have up to 80 million tests sometimes. And people use very stringent threshold to declare something to be associated, not to have too many false positive. And to have better power to detect what's really associated, people have merged into a huge consortium where multiple studies join together their forces to look for these association. It results, one of the challenges that we have, somebody was saying that their field, they work together. We work in large group. There are hundreds of authors in papers. And sometimes our main challenge is finding a reviewer who's not on the paper but knowledgeable to review. So to deal with the multiple layers of correlation, we use linear mixed effect models. We look for the fixed effect of the SNP on the phenotype, but we use random effects to account for the multiple layer of correlation. And we use a combination of publicly available software and a lot of R functions. And the Department of Biostatistics have provided a lot of these packages in our own development. We make these packages available to the wider community. So I wanted to give a little bit of results. This is what a result looking at fasting glucose in the Framingham Heart Study. Each of these points is a statistical test for a single nucleotide polymorphism, whether it's associated with fasting glucose or not. And I'm looking at the minus log 10 of the p-value, so the peaks are what I'm interested in. And it's called a Manhattan plot because of the skyscraper that you see when you have an association. So when I looked at the Framingham Heart Study, I was able to identify three genes that clearly influence fasting glucose. And fasting glucose is important in the development of type 2 diabetes. When I joined force with 54 other studies, this is what the Manhattan plot looks like. You have in blue the genes that were already identified with the with the Framingham Heart Study, but we were able to identify a lot, many more additional genes. And the final example, I needed to have a network, right, in this network session. So this is some of the work that I've done with people in the medical school looking at atrial fibrillation, and this is a network looking at, we took the protein-protein interaction as the network, and the weight on the node is the association with atrial fibrillation. And what we're looking at is we're looking at portion of this network that seems to be enriched with association with atrial fibrillation. Future direction. we found all these associated genes, but we don't know what they do. We need to team up with lab scientists to try to identify the function of these genes. These genes also do not fully explain the aggregation within family, the heritability. So there are other sources that could, if we jointly analyze all of our data, we might be better able to explain this heritability. We need to incorporate the knowledge that is generated from available database into all that. So we need to take a systems biology approach to incorporate all data available, and that requires a multidisciplinary team, and I welcome. I'd love to talk to you if you have the expertise to see how we can accomplish that. Thank you.
Thank you, Josee. Our next speaker is Plamen Ivanov. He's a research professor in the physics department, and he's the director of the Keck Laboratory for Network Physiology. He's going to speak to us about the human Physiolome, new big data from network physiology.
So, thank you for the opportunity. I would like to present to you some new ideas about a new developing field called network physiology and the potential impact it may have on developing a new kind of big data, the human physiolome. And we know that the human organism comprises various organ systems. And this is the heart, the lungs, eyes, kidneys, you know, various muscle groups, or the brain. And each one of those systems are complex systems. They have very complex structural organization, very complex mechanisms of underlying control. And this is also manifested by the complexity of the output signals that come and stream out of these systems at every moment of time. And how these streams of data actually continuously change depending on what we do. So researchers and medical specialists usually focus on individual organ systems, maybe because of the complexity of these organ systems. And however, the human organism is an integrated network. And organs continuously interact in order to optimize and coordinate their functions and in order to generate different physiologic states, such as, let's say, wake or sleep, let's say deep sleep or light sleep, consciousness or unconsciousness, or simply to maintain health. So we have health not only because we have healthy organs individually, but because of this complex network of interaction, a dynamical network of interaction between the organs. And if we alter or actually sever and interrupt these communications, then this could lead to dysfunction of individual organ systems, or actually in certain cases, like multiple organ failure or coma, it can lead to the collapse of the entire organism. So in the current research areas of systems biology and integrative physiology, the main focus is understanding the organization at the subcellular and cellular level to tissues and organs, and to understand all these complex signaling and feedback processes that transcend space and time scales. However, surprisingly, there is an absence of actually knowledge and focused research effort in the direction of this horizontal integration of interactions among diverse organ systems. And I want to stress this, that these are diverse systems, each one of which acting on different time scales, different type of dynamics. Some have more oscillatory, other more stochastic, or other more mixed. So as a result, we need to know what is the process behind this horizontal integration. This is very important to fill the gap between the knowledge here at the lower level of microscopic and mesoscopic scale related to systems biology, integrative physiology, and to link it with the large scale research and knowledge at the level of the human epidemiology. So we have developing ideas where we consider each organ system as a node of a network where these links represent the interactions. And here one node is the heart, another is the lungs, and another is maybe the chin muscle tone, and the leg movement, and eye movement, and different functions of the brain. And the question is, can we understand how this network evolves in time depending on changes of different physiologic states? And if, as an experimentalist, as a data scientist, if we look at the output signals that come out of these systems, these are really streams of continuously streaming data. And for example, you have a signal coming from the brain, and signal coming from the heart rate, and from the respiration, and from the eye movement. And one can see, by careful observation, that sometimes activations in the one system lead to corresponding activations in the other systems. So that burst in the activity is followed by a constant time delay by burst in the activity in the other system, and so on and so on. And this can continue in time for periods of time. So indicating, perhaps, that there is a presence of certain links and interaction between these very diverse systems. One can ask the question, what are the mechanisms behind? Can we find, can this network concept help us to observe something that is physiologically meaningful? And let's consider a one physiologic state represented here by this group of networks corresponding to deep sleep, and following after that another physiologic state of light sleep. And one can see that in this exact transition, which corresponds to a few seconds, there is a dramatic reorganization of the network of the interaction. Not only, it turns out, not only the structure of this network, but also the topology. And then one can say, well, if this happens in one particular instance, we have these transitions many times across, let's say, 8 hours of sleep, and we have transitions from deep sleep to light sleep, deep sleep to light sleep, always. Do we have the same? And it turns out that there are certain basic rules. This rule repeats always for this particular type of transition, indicating that perhaps such an approach can teach us something about basic knowledge of human physiology. And one can actually construct this type of networks and see a very strong association between network topology. You see how the network topology changes depending on physiologic state. For example, during deep sleep, the connectivity is much less. A bit more during REM sleep, even more during light sleep, and almost fully connected during wake. So there are certain stratification pattern in this network connectivity structure that appears to be a basic law and associated for every subject for various for this particular physiologic states. But not only the number of links, but also the strength of these links. All links here are represented by the same blue line, but they have different strength that varies in time. And this trend also follows is the same, apparently, stratification pattern. So this type of observations led us to develop a vision that we need, in addition to the current atlas of human physiology that you, and medicine that you see at every medical doctor's office, which represents the location and structure of individual organs, which, however, is a static picture. So our vision is to have a dynamical picture which represents these dynamical interactions between various organ systems in real time. This would revolutionize our knowledge of understanding and how these organ systems talk to each other. And of course, it may have important implications for clinical practice. And such an atlas would actually contain a set of maps, so-called blueprint reference maps, that would represent what is the typical type of interaction that we have between organ systems under healthy condition, what is the typical type of interaction when we have different age groups, for example, babies versus adults versus elderly, even though they are healthy, they may have different representation in these maps, or under various pathologic conditions like heart failure or coma or multiple organ failure. And it's not only to present a beautiful maps, it is also the information behind, because one needs to know what are the parameters that represent these dynamical interactions, these forms of coupling which continuously change in time, and what are the limits of this variability beyond which one would have emergence of pathologic condition. In other words, what is the critical zone of parameters describing dynamical interactions between diverse nodes, diverse systems, that would define health. It is surprising that even nowadays we define health by the health of the individual organ system. However, if we do not have the proper interactions, we would not have a healthy state. So the impact, of course, It's in multiple directions. One can derive novel biomarkers based on the coupling and interaction between organ systems. And again, remember that this coupling is transient. It changes in time from what I have shown. You can have one strand of coupling in a given moment, depending on what you do and depending on the physiologic state, and this can change minute by minute or hour by hour. So this can have impact of new generation of intensive care unit monitoring devices, where instead of a single monitor that represents a single physiological system, let's say monitoring your breathing or monitoring your oxygen concentration or the heart rate, you may have a monitor that represents an entire network of all organ, vital organ, key organ systems that are important to follow during the course of a patient in the critical care unit. Far more implications for various assessment, more comprehensive assessment of drugs. Usually drugs are targeted to help a particular organ system. The question is, we still do not understand very well how drugs affect interactions between these systems. So it has happened, actually, there were lawsuits in cases when drugs very well targeting particular ion channel kinetics to restore the function of the muscle of the heart would nevertheless lead to a little outcome just because certain interactions with breathing and our organ systems were severe. And ultimately, this can also require a new type of medical specialist, perhaps the type of Dr. House, where you take information from multiple directions and you combine information not only about specifics of particular organ system, narrow specialized, but also about this new information of networks of interaction between diverse organ systems. So we have a feeling that there is a strong parallel between these ideas and what it has actually happened in the context of the development of genetics. About 40 or 50 years ago, genetics was at the level of the discovering the DNA and identifying specific association between genomic mutations and particular diseases. And this accumulated over several decades, finally, to justify the investment and the effort to develop the human genome, which created a gigantic new data, as we saw in the previous talk, a new atlas of genomic maps, which in turn triggered the necessity to develop new approaches that would make sense of how this genomic information is related with particular diseases. And here is, for example, the map of the human disease network. And this in the future can go even to a super big network or data where we go in the direction of personalized genetics. So in the context of network physiology, understanding the mapping of interactions in real time of organ systems. And again, I'm stressing this is not a simple application of networks that we know it from the classical theory of networks to another object of application. Why? Because here each system is diverse. Each system is different and it has different dynamical patterns. So this poses a lot of challenges for us to develop the necessary instrumentarium and theoretical framework in order to address this problem. So we are here in developing this association between network structure and network dynamics, and to develop these initial maps that would potentially justify the effort to develop this human physiolome or an atlas of dynamical interactions of organ system, a gigantic set of dynamical maps representing in real time, in every minute, different physiologic states and function. This would have not only impact on understanding basic physiology, because we have to understand basic physiology not only from point of view of individual organs, but from point of view of the principles which govern their communications. And we, surprisingly, we don't know almost anything about it. So it will have not only importance for the basic knowledge, but also for various clinical implications, pharmaceutical development, and perhaps in the future, with the development of these personalized devices that we have all of us in our pocket, which tell us every morning the weather forecast with precision up to the hour and sometimes even half an hour, we would be able perhaps to develop a new view, a new public awareness and attitude towards health. So we, as a result, we started on the first step of developing a new field, network physiology, that would shift the focus from the individual organ systems to the entire network of organ interactions. And this has been recently supported very generously by the Keck Foundation in order to make some progress in this direction. So thank you very much for that.
Thank you, Plamen. And for our last speaker, it's my distinct privilege to introduce my longtime collaborator, Professor Eric Kolaczyk, who is a professor in the Department of Math and Statistics. He's in systems engineering, and he's also the director of the program in statistics. And he's going to talk about statistical network analysis and data science, the things we do well and the things we're still working on.
And could we just ask the other speakers to come sit up at the table so we're ready for our Q&A?
The other speakers are right there, but they cannot see if they sit at the table.
Do you want to walk with a mic or your speaker?
Walking would be wonderful. Thank you. Yeah.
Thank you. Yes, I feel very trapped when I stand behind a podium, so being able to walk will be wonderful. So thank you to the organizers. This is really an excellent event to have here at BU. We've had a number of, I need to be able to bring my talk, huh? How do I get my talk over?
Just hit the right arrow.
Just hit the right arrow? Ah, beautiful. Okay, thank you. So we've had three talks giving you a sense of networks coming in very distinct contexts. What I'm going to do, I'm a statistician by training, the systems engineering, so I have sort of a heavy dose of informal engineering. The engineers have been very kind letting me work with them over the years. What I want to do is show you a bit about networks from a statistician's perspective, and what that's going to mean is stepping back a little bit. One of the things about statistical training is that we work sort of like microscopes. We can zoom down into the details of a problem, but at the same time, we're trained to think in terms of abstractions, principles, templates, in terms of looking at problems and saying, you know, essentially the core of this problem, the core of this data, the challenge is this. But it's a little different than the typical. So how can we address what's different and develop, for example, a tool that's very familiar from Stat 101 for, say, a new data type like networks? And so this is very much at the heart of our training. So anytime within the history of data science, which goes back hundreds or thousands of years in principle, right? Because we've been collecting data for hundreds or thousands of years. Anytime there's something new and interesting that emerges in a large sort of fashion that stimulates our field and other fields, of course, as well, to continue to grow and stretch. So networks certainly has been one of the major driving forces in terms of developing new and interesting things in statistics to try and address the host of challenges that have arisen within sciences seeking to use network-oriented perspectives to answer questions that are of fundamental interest in their domain, right? So I looked, 1999 as sort of a watershed year in terms of going from classical network thinking to sort of what we call modern network thinking. And so I like to use that as a year to say how many articles were there that use network in their title. I did this a year ago, there were about 390-something thousand, so a year later we have 436,000. It gives you a sense as to what that curve would look like if I did one like Jay showed for his domain. Contributions have been from all over the data sciences. It is really, truly a highly diverse field and very representative in some sense of what's going on in data science in microcosm. Network analysis is something that traditionally was a very small sort of field. It arose in all sorts of fields. You have graph theory, you have context within chemistry, you have circuits, et cetera, but really sort of merging and exploding as an actual field out of itself began around the mid-late 1990s. I would say arguably it's due to a number of key factors. One is an increasingly systems level perspective in science. We saw in, I think, all three talks, actually, that preceded me, sort of mapping the progression of what we're able to measure with the Human Genome Project, right? And so Plamen's slide was excellent in showing, you know, we went down to the genetic level, and now what are we doing? right? We're beginning to put things together. We put them together vertically across different omics levels, and now they're putting together horizontally across the body of itself, right? This is very much part of what's driving the network-based perspective in the sciences. Also, without the data, you're not going to do much, right, in terms of a quantitative and analysis perspective. So the ability to have high throughput data in very high dimensions, if you're talking about all these different omics, you need to be able to measure something at all those different levels. If you're talking now about time series, for example, we just saw there in terms of different organs, you need to be able to measure them simultaneously, right, and be able to compare them. And then the ability simply to gather that data, exchange that data, to share that data, the collaborations that Josee spoke about, for example, which has at least dozens of cohorts from around the world working together, all of that is highly non-trivial as well. So where is statistics in all this? Really everywhere, from the instant you start thinking about obtaining data, through to the gathering of data, to the analysis, the visualization of the data, modeling, inference, prediction. But what's wonderful for people like me is that I get to go through all these topics that if you look at it and you think, yeah, I saw those in Stat 101, you didn't see the versions you need for networks in Stat 101. Because just bringing networks to bear fundamentally changes certain aspects of what is otherwise familiar. Right? And that is what both allows us to have hope that we can do things that we're used to doing in standard context, and also keeps my field young and fresh in the ability that we have challenges to continue to extend our methodologies. Right? So this is hence the title of my talk, which was saying that what we do well and what we're still working on. Because our growth as a field parallels the growth of areas like this. And so with the networks exploding the way they have, there's much we can do well. I would say that we have a very good grip on description and visualization. You would be surprised. You say, ah, that's descriptive statistics. Yes, and that takes about a week or two when we teach Stat 101. You would be surprised how much literature there is on descriptive statistics of networks. Right. In fact, a large fraction of the work that's out there is essentially highly non-trivial descriptive statistics of networks. And we have a great deal of modeling and inference we do, but still very fundamental challenges. Prediction, still fundamental challenges, despite all the work that's out there. Right. So what I want to do is give you a sense with just three little vignettes as to what some of these challenges are, connecting them to things that everyone should be familiar with from a Stat 101 type treatment of courses, and give you just a little flavor of why they're also challenges and show you that we're making progress on them. Right? Why all of these have a challenge? First of all, the data are fundamentally different. They're relational, right? There are two things are connected, is the essence of the network, right? So that's relational data. Very often, the relational is speaking to some notion of statistical dependence, right? However, typically, your data is not in the form of a real number or a vector or a matrix that we're used to dealing with. There are ways, of course, to put the networks into such formats, but fundamentally, you lack a traditional notion of geometry that's accompanying Euclidean-type data. And that's a fundamental barrier that comes in very obvious ways and often very subtle ways in the analyses that we do. And then finally, of course, in many of these contexts, we're talking about very large networks, so any of the challenges that come with big data are also coming in here. Right? We have faced these types of things before when we move from the IID data that Josee mentioned in the intro classes and you move to time series data. Right? There's fundamental things that had to be dealt with to come up with time series analogs of IID data. Spatial data. Spatial data, you go, oh, well, that's also correlated. Yes, but on which axis? It's no longer then, now, future. Right? It's here, there, 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 which maybe all of those dependencies are in the same direction. Maybe they change with direction. Just adding that one dimension allows you to have challenges in developing the familiar to a new data setting. Right? So let me show you,
plug-in or power source. All right. Let's hit OK. No? All right, that's at least moving us forward, so I'll use that button.
All right. So I'm going to show you these three vignettes, one slide each, right? This is the lightning session after all. I want to talk to you about adjusting for bias due to sampling. I want to show you something about propagating uncertainty, because there's almost always uncertainty in the links in your networks. And then I want to talk to you about moving from very large networks to moving to big in a different axis, meaning many networks. All right? All of these with one slide. All right. So this is a project that we just finished about a year ago with a colleague and a PhD student of mine. Suppose you have a very large network, and when you see something, you're sure you've seen it. Right? So for example, Facebook or some of these, whoa, okay, so I'll keep talking here. Because they're gonna probably not turn my clock off, right? So I have a social media network. I'm pretty confident about what I see when I see it, but I may not see everything, right? So there's often a sense of sampling going on in these networks, right? A fundamental characteristic of networks is how connected any given node is, your so-called degree. You can look at a histogram of these degrees. You get a degree distribution. This is considered a fundamental descriptor of a network. Right? If I sample a network, then the sample histogram I get is not the actual histogram I want. Right? And it turns out that sampling can move that histogram in ways that are non-trivial. They're hard to sort of intellectually think, ah, it just moves it this way. I'll just shift it back. Right? So how do you deal with that? For certain types of samplings, you can actually set up a linear inverse problem, right? Essentially a sort of regression problem. But the linear operator is ill-conditioned. So it's not a very friendly linear inverse problem. But you can use some of the optimization-based statistical machine learning principles that have been developed in the last 20 years. You can apply it in this particular context, and you can take these histograms, which would be up here, see? You can take the one that's right there, and you can shift it over to here, which is lying right on the truth, and in fact, you can't even tell the difference. If we move to the next topic. Next slide, please. Thank you. The networks that Jay showed you, for example, the networks that Josee showed you, for example, and I'm sure some of the ones that Plamen showed you as well, all these are based on biological data where we say there's some sort of notion of correlation that is having to do with my measurements and your measurements, this gene's measurements and those gene measurements, whether or not these two proteins link. So there's noise. Some of the links that I think I see, they're not there. Some of the links that I don't see, actually they're there. Okay, so you have so-called type 1, type 2 error, right, in these networks. Now you say, give me a number about that network. I love that pretty picture. How dense is it? Oh, about 20% of the possible edges are there. So they call that the density of a network. And I say, are you sure? Yeah, no, because I know there's noise. Okay, then can you give me a confidence interval on that? That's stat 101, right? We're still working on how to do it. To show you how odd that is, if you have a very sparse network with just a little bit of noise, you think, oh, well, you know, density is like an average, thank you, right? Density is like an average. And averages at some point have Gaussian-like behavior, so you say plus or minus some z value for your normal noise, right? If it's sparse enough, it's not normal. It's this funny thing called skellum. Skellum is a difference of two Poissons, because it turns out there's more of a counting regime going on than there is an averaging regime. But if you start looking not at density of edges but triangles, our most recent simulation suggests that for the same sparsity that you got this weird skellum thing for one edge, for three edges, you actually do get Gaussian. We're currently at the go figure stage of that work.
All right, one last project here.
Stat 101 for collections of networks. This is a current grant from the Army that we're working with a colleague in geometry and also in probability. Here's the idea. Instead of having one big, enormous network, how about many, many, many small networks? Jay mentioned the ADNI study, for example. This is a similar sort of study based in England. It's the 1,000 Connectomes Project, right? So each of the types of networks that Jay was talking about from an individual, we have one for, say, this group and that group. And we want to know the average network for that group. I'm not sure what that means, but whatever that average network concept means, how does it differ from this average network? And can I do, say, a t-test for averages of networks, right? So what we've done is begun to develop that type of theory. Currently, what's done is people go through with individual edges, and they say, for these two brain regions, let's find the frequency that there was an edge across patients, right? And then we do know how to do a test of binomial proportions from STAT 101. So we could do that on every single one of the pairs of vertices. But then, similar to what Josee talked about, you have many, many, many tests to do, so you have to do multiple correction, but that tends to severely reduce your power statistically, right? So what you find is that this is uncorrected for testing, where this is all the nodes by all the nodes, and this means there was a link on average. This wipes out a bunch of it. That may actually be fine, because there's a lot of noise in that data. But this is based on all 1,000 people. If you say, well, I'm working in a small lab, which is similar to what a lot of the labs here in brain and psychology do, for example, and I have 20 patients and 20 patients, right? Then we know by small sample size, you're going to lose that power. This is going to be empty, right? So what we did is we first defined what do you mean by an average of networks. You have to actually go back all the way to the geometry and think about what is a right way to think about a space of networks. On that geometry, on that space then, you have to actually talk about what it means to have a probability distribution on that space, and you sample from it. Having done that, maybe with a little luck, if all the elements of are nice enough mathematically, you get a central limit theorem. You get a central limit theorem that says, now my average does behave Gaussian-like, which is what all of the STAT 101 Z values are based on. That's the theoretical underpinning. So you can finally talk about a chi-square test, which is what we developed here. And for even up to things like 10 patients in each of two different settings, we have roughly the same power that these uncorrected methods have when they're going one by one by one. And what is it exploiting? Back to my last point that I made at the very beginning there, it's exploiting the principles. Fundamental principles of multivariate statistics, where if you have correlation among the entries, you can get a more powerful test by exploiting those correlations. So it's taking the old and familiar and the principles that our discipline is based on and using them in new ways, looking through new eyes at a new problem, right? And that really is what statistics is about. Lots of people involved with this, lots of support. This is the barest of thanks I can give them, and thank you again to the speakers.
So we're going to start the Q&A session now. There's going to be a microphone, as just in the last session, there's a microphone. Linda's got a microphone over here, and here's another one. And I just ask that you would introduce yourself before asking your question and try to keep your questions kind of short so we can get as many questions in the time we've got. Okay, open for questions. Right here, Valentin.
You've got it on the left first.
Oh, sorry.
Hi, I'm Amanda Gaudreau-Balderrama. I'm a graduate student in electrical engineering. Those were some really interesting talks, a lot about the, you know, quantify self-movement and then the fitness movement, and I'm really interested in that. So more specifically, it's for Professor Ivanov.
Yes.
And actually, others on the panel, I think, are qualified to answer as well, but the question is, so you're creating a network, you showed some examples of deep sleep, but say we're trying to look at something, you know, a more anomalous thing that happens, like a heart attack, or, you know, you're trying to look at rare health things that are happening. How would you propose that you can make a reliable network, or that you might be able to model that? And then furthermore, once you have data, say you only have like a heart rate and, you know, a couple other non-invasive things, like not an EEG or something like that, then how would you be able to predict those things if nodes of the network are missing? Are there techniques that exist out there? So I guess it's a kind of a two-part question. The first is, you know, how do you classify data or label data when you are, or are you kind of just working on the network problem? And then the second one is, when you're missing nodes, then how do you make predictions and inferences?
Yes, so you put your finger directly in the spot. Of course, we would like to have the instrumentarium to be able to identify exactly critical events like heart attacks or particular responses to medications. Let's say you have a patient in the critical care unit. The patient comes with a particular complaint, with a particular problem, with a particular organ. And then, let's say, this develops. And there are other effects that multiply and are responded, correspondingly reflected by other organs. So can we track not only the individual organ time series or the individual organ signal output, but also all others simultaneously in a very synchronized way? And can we have sensitive computational and also analytic technology that would be able to reliably identify causality and coupling between events? If you have, let's say, a arrhythmic beats associated with ventricular arrhythmia in the heart that triggers a heart attack, is this preceded by certain modifications in the strength of coupling or directionality of the coupling between the heart and other vital organ systems? And so this is exactly where we want to go. And of course, then the question is, if you have one organ system that falls out of the network, then can we still have, can we still save the patient? And where is the limit where maybe few organs are maybe not completely functioning the way how they are expected under normal condition, but there are certain modification in the strength or the functional form of coupling of these organs with the rest? How can this lead to a global emergent behavior of the particular clinical condition? And so these are questions that are very unique for this particular field, because you may have very few nodes. You may have only 20 or 30 nodes. Nevertheless, because of their diversity and because their dynamical interactions, you have a very gigantic phase space of conditions that you can generate by just few nodes. And so this is the challenge. So we do not know, usually in networks, when you define dynamics of network, you define the particular node and you say, okay, what is the transfer of information or the traffic specifically through this node? But how can we define the global behavior of network that comes as a result of multiple dynamics of each node? And so we do not have, especially for small networks, what type of mechanism? In statistical physics, we have something like a mean field, but perhaps we cannot quite apply this in this case. So this also goes in the direction to the lecture of Eric, where all these questions have to be addressed, and especially to be able to have technology that can really identify reliably that you have coupling, because in real subjects, we it's not like in the physics lab, where you can test the coupling.
Oh, thanks.
Okay. Could I maybe ask the other three panelists to address the question of missingness in their in networks and their own work? I know each of you are dealing with them in some capacity. And we'll keep it short so we can move a little bit late to lunch.
So I call, as a statistician, I call missing data job security, because there's always new methods and new technique needed to try to in my field, we sometimes impute the missing data. Sometimes we try to use all the information, but it is a big problem and a source of many PhD theses.
So the from a general perspective, the key thing with missingness is always the mechanism of missingness, right? That's sort of the formal phrase we always say. Why is it missing? How might it be missing? You may not know, but that's often the key thing of trying to get a handle of it. The other thing is the interaction of that mechanism with the units that are involved. So with a network, you have your vertices, you have your edges, right? One of the problems that we have reasonable handle on in the literature is the so-called link prediction problem. If you have missing links, but you know all the vertices, then depending on the context of your problem, whether it's watching the World Wide Web grow or whether it's having protein interactions that you didn't measure all the proteins, for example, there are methods that people have tried for some of these specific problems to drop in links when they should be there. But if you have units of nodes missing, then there could be whole subspaces of your network that you don't even know whether there's one or 10 or 100 of those nodes there. And so from a ordering point of view, that makes for a much harder class of problems. And I think there's much less work out there that's on that.
Yeah, we certainly have problems of missing data, but this makes me think about another problem that's, I think, related, which is something we've been grappling with in functional MRI networks, functional connectivity networks, in patients who have strokes. And so in this case, we have node removal that has happened due to an injury to the brain. And so one of the questions we've been focused on is, when you remove a node in the network, how do we know sort of the differences in the organization of the network that are natural consequences of removing those nodes versus reorganization that has taken place after the injury. So that's a problem that I think is really an interesting one. And one of the things that we found is that simple removal of a set of nodes in a brain network can lead to extraordinary reorganization just by simple removal, right? The properties of the network can change quite drastically, as we know. So there's a lot of work to be done here.
That's great. Wow. Okay, Yanis.
Yanis Paskalidis from the College of Engineering. This is a question for Professor Dupuis. You mentioned the Framingham data set, and I guess you are looking for causes for diabetes, genetic or otherwise. My question is whether that data set is amenable to looking for improving the management of diabetes, and of whether you know other work that relates to that.
So I think it's got limited utility because there's no intervention in the Framingham heart data study other than having visits. They're healthier than the normal population because they go every 2 years for visits, which raises some consciousness about health issues. But there's no intervention, so I cannot tell you. I can tell you in observation if people taking a particular treatment to have a better management of type 2 diabetes. But these people taking a particular treatment could be different for other reasons from the people not taking the particular treatment. So it's an observational, there's a lot of things I can do, but management of diabetes is not the ideal data set.
I have a question for all of you, I think. All of these networks that you sort of described have so many applications in urban sustainability, and there's a big focus now on looking at how does the networks in a city operate and function together, like transportation network, natural gas leaks, where our department has spent a lot of time looking at explosions, electric grids, water supplies, and so on. And we've always looked at it as one network at a time. We've never put it together. So we, like today, Baltimore and Washington have snow, you know, problems, and the networks are not sort of, you know, coming together in order to provide information. So do you have any ideas? And I'm also interested in asking health-related questions because obesity is a big problem in all urban areas. And I wanted to talk to you about how do you improve from all what you've learned? How do you give that kind of information and make perhaps an app, you know, so people can live better lives?
Maybe I'll jump in on the general question. So what they call multi-networks or multi-nets, there's variations on that concept right now, is one of the frontiers, I would say, of general complex network research, is this idea of having multiple networks and wanting to analyze them together. Structurally, on the one hand, that becomes a harder problem because it's the analog of going from a single measurement to multivariate measurements. Only each of your objects are networks. On the other hand, the context you're describing, there is a great deal of domain knowledge to be able to leverage in the fact that a lot of the networks you mentioned are actually spatial networks or highly spatially informed. I know that some of the leading work that's being done on multi-networks is actually working with engineered systems because they're a fairly natural context and a somewhat feasible one to work with for the reasons I said.
Okay, I think we have time for one more question.
Thank you so much for this very exciting session. In addition to analyzing networks or all the issues that we have with inference and even coming to coupled or interdependent networks that the previous question asked, we're coming close, or we're already in a world where we need inference now or yesterday. And we have complex analysis of problems, issues, maybe even data, big data, usage to come up with these inferences, but I wanted you to comment if at all any progress has been made in really using real-time data for real-time inferences, helping, for instance, policymakers to identify certain crises and react before it spreads throughout the system or coupled networks or affects the whole world. So that's my question.
Real time?
Do you want a real time answer? Yeah. I mean, so there are, as there's feeding me here, anomaly detection is certainly one. There, if you look in the engineering and DSP literature, for example, where a lot of these desires to have this type of stuff done has been asked, it has been looked at how to bring online type methods, how to deal with the question of data throughput, the data reduction, all the, there's sort of I would call them standard challenges, but I don't mean that in a kind of trivial way. But there are things that you can say are pieces of the overall problem, and it has been worked on certainly, and even within a network context, in the sense of what is it that we can exploit with the network-based context, what is it that makes it harder. I would say look probably in that sort of literature where people have large sensor networks or you're doing anomaly detection in the internet. Mark and I have done some that sort of work. Moving it to real time, and I'm going to guess, knowing you a bit, in the context of financial, global financial networks, for example, you have to ask yourself, have they, and I don't know this, you probably know it better than I do, have they solved the problem of how to get all that information to what? Someplace central, someplace distributed? The data sharing problem is very different. These have fundamental implications that even in the computer network traffic context also had to be worked out. Distributed algorithms are going to be different than centralized algorithms, et cetera, et cetera. But there's probably a healthy conversation that could be had in that direction.
All right.
Go ahead. Just 1 second. There's also a lot that is done in that in infectious diseases, looking at how these spread and really trying to get real time to stop these epidemics.
Yeah. Great. All right, well, let's thank our speakers one more time.
And also our moderator, Professor Provello. So before we disperse for the break, just a few announcements. Those of you who want to keep in touch with Buds, we have a Twitter and hashtag, I mean, called Buds2016. So Buds2016 is a Twitter tag. We have a lunch over a poster session, a student poster session. We have a very diverse group of posters ranging from computer science, mathematics, statistics, engineering, also political science, public health, physics, and so forth. And also across undergraduates, master's students, and PhD students. So you can grab lunch at the East End lounge to my left, and then make your way towards the atrium and the room next door for the poster session. And since we are ending on a networks panel, I'd like to encourage all of you to network with each other and build connections. That's the main function of this event. So we'll see you in at around in about an hour and 15 minutes.
I'd also like to suggest that people perhaps stagger their going to the line. Maybe some of you take your turns out in the poster sessions now rather than waiting for a long time to get your food. Thank you.
If I could test my laptop.
We can't, no, because we have all the